Okay, this will be an overview of the domain name system. So we've already talked in another video about the host file, and that's a locally maintained file for managing name resolution, managing it only for a single computer. And you can share host files between computers, but that has to be done manually. .NET BIOS is Microsoft's system, and that's only useful for local networks, and that's kind of a peer-to-peer name resolution where each system that connects to the network shares its names with the others that are on the network. And finally, we have the domain name system, DNS, and that is a global system, and that is probably the name resolution system that you're most familiar with. So DNS, a domain name in DNS, consists of three parts, basically. It has the top-level domain, the TLD, and then the domain name that's attached to the top-level domain. And then finally, a host name specific to a certain computer connected to that domain. And the way DNS is organized is a hierarchy, and it starts at the end of the domain name. Now, what you may not know is that at the end of the domain name, there's an implicit dot. It's invisible. You don't have to type it most of the time, but it's there. And that dot represents the root. And the root is globally managed, and that manages DNS for everyone. And when the root servers go down, that's bad for everyone. Underneath the root, you have your top level domains. So com, net, org, edu, mil, gov, those are the top level domains that basically everybody purchases a domain from one of those top level domains. So the root, what the root does is points to the name servers for the top-level domain. So if you see a new top-level domain you've never seen before, .games, for example, I'm sure that's one. If you see .games and you don't know who the name servers are for .games, you would ask root, and root would know who the name servers are for .games. And then .games would have the name servers for every domain name that's purchased under .games. So if you have video.games, if I owned the domain video.games, the .games name servers would point to my name servers for video. So if someone requested video.games, that would go from the root to the .games subdomain, or to the, sorry, from the root to the .games top level domain to the video.games domain name. And then if I wanted to have www.video.games, I could point to where those are. And we'll talk about DNS records and how that kind of happens in another video. So here is a typical URL you might see, and there's a lot of parts to that URL. So at the beginning, you can see the protocol, http://, and that is not at all to do with DNS. That tells your browser what the protocol is that you're communicating with. And so that is, throw that out for this discussion. At the end, after .com, there's a slash page.html. That is also not part of DNS. That's the URI, the Uniform Resource Identifier, and that is not part of DNS. DNS is everything in between those two. So the .com is our top level domain. And remember, there's an invisible implicit dot after .com. And again, that's implied. You can actually type that dot and it won't break anything. And then after dot, or before .com, there's the sweetness. The sweetness.com is the domain name that I would have purchased from a domain name registrar. So if I wanted the sweetness.com, I go to GoDaddy or 1and1.com or Namecheap.com, and I say, I want the sweetness.com, and I would pay them 10 bucks per year to register that domain. And then once I own the sweetness.com, I can do whatever I want before that. So here I have www.cool.site.thesweetness.com. And that has a bunch of different names. It's a subdomain. It's also the host name. So the host name referring to a specific machine. And we'll talk about that when we talk about DNS resource records. And then the whole thing all together can sometimes be called the domain name. So sometimes the domain name is just thesweetness.com. Sometimes the domain name, or the fully qualified domain name, FQDN, is www.cool.site.thesweetness.com. And that is all DNS. And that's all taken care of in DNS. And the whole point of that is to translate all of that information, www.cool.site.thesweetness.com, into an IP address that your computer can use to point to a specific machine somewhere in the world, some machine's address, so that your computer can talk to it. So for the root name servers, there are 13 root name servers in the world. And that's sort of true. There are actually 13 logical servers and 504 physical servers. So we'll show a map coming up here in a little bit. And those servers are distributed all over the world. And when you want to access one of those servers using a technology called Anycast, you're able to connect to one, the closest server to you. So those root servers maintain the root zone file, which the root zone file says where the servers are for all of the top level domains. So com, edu, gov, .us, .uk, all of the top level domains all around the world are maintained in those root server file, in the root zone file. And to find out where the root servers are, you typically ship a little file to point to the root servers. It's called the root hints file. And that points to those root name servers. And that's shipped in your operating system or in your software that you're using to connect to the network. The domain names for those root servers are a.rootservers.net through m.rootservers.net. And here's that map I was telling you about. So A through M, they are all over the world. We've got a whole bunch in South America, a whole bunch in North America, tons in Europe, all across Asia, up and down Africa, Australia. Everybody's got root name servers. And when you connect, so you see a lot of blue dots there for L. And if you try to go to l.root-servers.net, Anycast will direct you to the closest server to you. So even though all of those servers all across the world have the same name, you'll get directed to the closest one to you to get those DNS requests as quickly as possible, because information takes time to travel all across the world. And if the only DNS servers for l.rootservers.net were in Kansas, for example, if you were in the middle of Russia, you would have to wait for the data to get to Kansas and back to you, and that takes a long time. So there actually have been a couple attacks on the root servers, only a couple that were marginally successful. So in 2002, there was an attack that lasted all for an hour, and it targeted all 13 root name servers, and four of them managed to keep working. So DNS has not gone down globally, as far as I'm aware, ever. And then in February 2007, another one, this one lasted a lot longer, but it was much more restricted. So it targeted GNL and FNM, and the rest of the servers were unaffected by that attack. So we're going to talk just a little bit more about top-level domains. Now, originally, we had six top-level domains, com, edu, gov, org, net, and mil. And those were the only generic top-level domains. Generic meaning they're not restricted to a certain country. And they are restricted in use. EDU, for example, is for educational institutions. MIL is for the military. And you weren't able to purchase a .mil address from anybody you wanted. But now there are over 1,200 top-level domains. And there's a link in the description here for the list of internet top-level domains on Wikipedia. And there are tons of them. And that was actually a move by ICANN, the organization that basically decides what to do with DNS, to open that up, because com and net and org were full, basically. And to get a unique .com or .org or .net domain name, you had to fight and you had to mess with the name of your business to get that. And so in order to open up the market a little bit, they created a whole bunch more generic top-level domains, like .games, and you've probably seen a bunch of others, and you can look at that list and see a bunch of others. Now, another interesting thing is that when we have top-level domains, we also have country code top-level domains. So we had generic top-level domains for everybody, country code top-level domains for each country. And each country in the world got their own top-level domain that they could do with what they wanted. So .us is for America, for the United States, .uk for the United Kingdom. And a couple countries kind of got lucky, and they kind of struck it rich in terms of country code top-level domains. Tuvalu, an island nation with less than 11,000 people, at least last time I checked the population, they got .tv. And so they decided to lease the rights for .tv for $50 million. So this little country of less than 11,000 people gets $50 million just because they won the country code top-level domain lottery and got .tv, which is a very popular one for television stations. We also have another one you've probably seen is Montenegro, which got .me, .me. And so they're popular. Colombia got .co, which is, I think a lot of people think it's just a shorter version of .com. It's used for things like Twitter's URL shortener, t.co. .fm in Micronesia, last.fm and other radio and music sites have that. And then the last one we'll talk about, there's others, but belgium.be. So YouTube uses .be, Belgium's, for shortening their URL. So if you shorten a YouTube link, it's youtube.be. And that's it for an overview of DNS. We've covered top-level domains and kind of the hierarchical organization and the root name servers for DNS. In another video, we'll talk about resource records that DNS uses.